Welcome, everybody, to the loudest podcast, on the internet. I'm your host, Asterios Kokonos. With us, as always, is Sriracha.
Hello.
All right, we got a lot to talk about this week. Later in the episode, we've got the Thought Cops and Niko coming on to discuss Netflix's hot new cartoon, Chicago Party On.
Netflix's hot new cartoon, It's Ugly as Sin.
But first, there's some news. We got a dog.
We didn't get a dog. We borrowed a dog.
For 1 week. We got a dog. My little brother is out of town, and he needed someone to watch their brand new 9-month-old puppy, Lily. And originally, he was going to give it to me. And then he very quickly reconsidered. He was like, actually, I think it might be safer if I drove 2 hours away from New York City to let our elderly parents watch. You know the people that like need canes to get around? We feel safer with these two old people that are at extreme fall risk to watch a 9-month-old puppy than you, a 39-year-old guy who lives 10 blocks from me.
No, I am so happy that they did not decide to leave the dog at your parents' house. Could you imagine that dog and its needs and its constant needs with your elderly parents?
Oh, no. My elderly parents wanted the dog.
Oh.
I had to guilt my little brother into letting me watch Lily because you were going out of town. You were going to visit your pals.
Yeah.
And I called up my little brother and I was like, oh, I heard you're going to let mom and dad watch the dog. It's going to be pretty lonely all by myself in the apartment. My fiance is going to be away, and well, I guess I could catch up on Family Feud. And he was like, do you want the dog? And I was like, it would be nice to have a little company around.
A little bit of company near me. I don't know. What do you think? You want to just get in the car and drive it 2 hours away out to the middle of fucking nowhere?
Everybody wanted to do that but me. Lily is totally insane. She has to be walked 3 times a day. She's like a brand new puppy. And she is constantly just hurling herself at anything, living or dead, dog or human, car or boat on the back of a car trailer. Like, she leaves the ground for a significant amount of time. She takes flying leaps like a goddamn missile, she's doing like Street Fighter moves to try to attack like babies, dogs 8 times the size of her, old people who are like grimacing in fear.
It's so, look, listeners, this dog needs a whole harness. It needs a flight suit because if we put it on a regular leash, it would hang itself.
Yes, and because she keeps trying to like, again, leave the ground. She hates being on the ground. She's constantly almost jumping out of the harness, which is terrifying. She would never come back. There's a whole world of smells out there for her to explore. She's already smelled this whole apartment. She's bored of it.
Right, and God help you if you see another dog out there. Oh, my God. I've never seen anything move as fast towards its own death than Lily throwing herself at a gigantic dog that could easily destroy her.
That could easily destroy us! Like, there was a dog the size of a tank being walked by a man the size of a tank. And I was just like, oh, Lily, no, no, no. I get that that dog's butthole is a world of information. But like, please, we've got buttholes at home. She is like, she's leaping at babies, which is making the babies cry.
And is incredibly funny.
Yeah, I mean, no, it's really fucking funny how terrible, like, we are traumatizing all of Brooklyn walking this dog around. And then the other thing is, though, that this dog, we haven't even described the dog. I don't know what kind of dog it is. I don't know what dog kinds are. People stop me on the street and they're like, what kind of dog is this? I'm like, I don't, it's my brother's dog.
Dumpster dog.
I don't know what kind of dog it is. But people are stopping me on the street. This dog is like a commercial dog.
She really is. She looks like a dog food commercial dog.
Yeah. She looks like, her hair is so beautiful. Like, she looks like a dog from like a dog shampoo commercial. She's like the after dog if you start using some kind of dog product.
Yeah.
And people stop me on the street. And they're doing something that they've never done to me before, which is smile at me and not be terrified in my presence.
Yeah, because you're a giant man with a fucking little tiny itsy bitsy dog.
Yeah. I, for the first time, the people are striking up conversations with me. They're like, what kind of dog do you have? How old is the dog? They're smiling at me. They're trusting me. It's so strange to be like wanted for the first time by society.
Because you have a dog. All you need to do is add a dog.
Yeah. A villain would never have a dog. A bad guy could never have such a cute dog, right? Instant trust.
Yeah, you should lure store owners outside with the dog and then I'll go in and steal everything.
I would absolutely do that.
Cooperation.
That's a really fucking good idea. The other night I'm taking Lily out for a walk and, you know, you're not supposed to bring dogs into stores, but I really want a Diet Coke. So I took her into a 7-Eleven. And she's terrified to go in. I'm dragging her across the floor. And it's like a tile floor. So she's like skittering on her little nails and paws. Like she's like sliding across the floor. Like it's the fucking Ice Capades. And I expect that the lady at the 7-Eleven is just going to start screaming at me. Like, get that fucking dog out of here and never come back again. Like, no, she wants to see the dog. She wants to pet the dog. Like she starts kissing the dog and making out with the dog. Strangers are making out with the... You saw it!
Yeah, that was fucking weird. Like people just will randomly stop. And I really don't like when she licks my face. But man, some of these old ladies around here really just want nothing more than to tongue fuck the dog.
Yeah. And I feel like a hero because it's like I'm helping, I'm brightening people's day. This dog is running up to like homeless people, running up to the terrified and the dog lover alike. Like I'm spreading some joy around fucking Bay Ridge.
This dog also does something that I've never seen a dog do, which is piss right in the middle of the road.
Yeah. Which you got to give her credit. Like that's unmarked territory. Like all these trees are taken. She's expanding her piss to like bolt new heights.
I wonder if it's a pain in the ass for her. Like, oh man, this is my tree. I guess I just got to piss right directly in the middle of the sidewalk.
No, I think it's
let it leak onto the road.
Galaxy brain thinking because then cars run over that piss and take it all over. And next thing you know, she's the queen of Bay Ridge.
Oh, you're right.
So I'm taking her for a walk the other night. Like it's Saturday night. Like it's late. You got to take her out a lot. And of course, there's all these drunks out. And she's launching herself at drunks sitting on bus benches who are terrified because it's dark. So they just think a giant rat is flying at their face.
Oh my God, she's about the size of a giant mutant rat.
Yeah, she is. She's the size of like a raccoon or something. And I'm always like, oh, I'm so sorry. She's only 9 months old. She's a baby. I'm so sorry. But they're just like, this dog makes life worth living. I'm like, this dog is really helping people.
She's a real brightener. I think I might be allergic to the dog.
Look, I'm allergic to the dog too. I haven't been able to sleep.
Me neither.
No. And when I wake up, I feel like I caught COVID-19 overnight. My throat is all scratchy. I fucking got more mucus than Woody Allen movie in my fucking throat. But we're like Patch Adams. We're healing people through the power of love. And
through the power of puppy.
Through the power of puppy power. That's a thing. It's a boomer thing the boomers used to say.
Oh my gosh, we should dress her up as a Paw Patrol character for Halloween.
We should dress her up as Chase the Blue Lives Matter dog.
Yeah, okay.
You know who would love that?
Our neighbors.
Our fucking neighborhood. Like, right out the window right now, there's a Blue Lives Matter flag. Hoisted above a 12-foot talking skeleton. I mean, it kind of sucks because it's like, I'm not a fan of that flag, but I love your Halloween spirit.
Your Halloween skeleton that talks for 12 fucking hours a day.
Yeah, I forgot because it says the same thing every year. And today, it's especially loud. It says things like, I was built from the sticks of a dying tree. And it's like, okay, well, I mean, all trees... Yeah, look, if you rip off a tree's sticks, it's going to be dying. Like, all sticks are technically dead trees. But still, the way it says it is still creepy.
Yeah, I think I had that memorized last year because it just sits there and talks ad nauseum all day and all night.
You know how
day.
He goes, and all it takes is your bones.
Your bones or your soul?
Soul, you're right, it's soul. Yeah. What the fuck is he talking about? This skeleton is talking nonstop, but... Honor System Candy Bowl.
Honor System Candy Bowl. Oh my God, let's go dump it in our pants.
I fucking get candy from that skeleton all the time. I really like that skeleton.
Are you serious? It's full right now?
Yes.
Oh my God, that's terrible for our diet.
Yeah, I know. But it tastes good.
It do taste good.
Oh, some more things about Lily, who, by the way, I may not give back.
You got to shove her. I mean, we're going to need to invest in Zyrtec if we are.
Yeah. Another thing I wanted to say about Lily is, so me and Sriracha were taking Lily around for a walk, and Sriracha said, God damn, it's a shame. It's a shame you're dating me, because otherwise this... What did you say?
I said that if it's a real shame that you're already spoken for, because if you weren't, you would get so much pussy. I bet just walking that dog around, like, oh my God, people were stopping us. People were fawning over the dog. I imagine it would be really easy to pick up women with this dog.
Okay, and which of course made me think, like, it's weird that you're like, my fiance could crush a lot of puss. If I wasn't in the picture.
Well, listen, if I die, maybe of
That's
a car
That's another thing you said the other day that I didn't like. You were talking about if you die, I could use this dog to crush puss.
Yeah, oh my God. Yeah, no.
These are weird thoughts to be having, Sriracha.
You heard it first, listeners. If I die, I want you to move on and crush puss with the dog, using the dog as a medium.
You also said the other day that if we ever get divorced, I better ask for the dog in the divorce settlement. Otherwise, you're taking the dog.
Yeah.
We're not even married yet, and you're talking about the terms of our divorce?
Woo! Lily, who do you want to live with? Mom or dad? Two Christmases?
Lily does not like eating food. I've never seen this kind of behavior in a dog. My little brother had to buy this dog, like, specialty frozen food that has to be, like, mixed up with, like, a mortar and pestle and, like, ground into a fine paste and then, like, lovingly placed in a bowl, like, right in front of her. And then you got to go to the other room and close your eyes so that she doesn't think you're going to steal her food. The only time she feels comfortable eating is, like, when there's no eyes on her. And it's like, well, I can kind of relate to that. I don't like to people see me eating either. I look like a big fat pig.
Right, like a model. Like, she only eats when only God is watching her.
Yeah. Lily, very, very picky. Oh, and then the last thing about Lily is, for some reason, she loves leaving the apartment. Coming back to the apartment terrifies her.
This blows my fucking mind that this dog has no problem walking down steps, but up steps you basically have to drag her.
Yeah, something about the steps scares her, but only in one direction. And I sat with her on the steps for like 10 minutes, like giving her treats. I tried to put like one treat on each step, like when they used Reese's Pieces to capture E.T. She like was not going for it. Like, I tried, like, pulling her up, and then I just ended up, like, lifting her off the ground in her harness, and she's, like, flying around like Peter Pan. I'm like, well, this is dangerous. I have to put you back down now, I guess. And then you had to carry her up the steps like a goddamn baby.
Yeah, I did, because she wouldn't even get near the steps.
She loves, by the way, being carried around like a goddamn
baby. Like a little baby.
The other day, she jumped out of half of her harness on the street. And I was so terrified of, like, that, oh, if I try to fix the harness and take the harness off, she's going to end up, like, running into a cement mixer or something. And so I picked her up, and she was like, this is way better than walking. Thank you for carrying me. I carried her, like, 4 blocks home.
If you keep doing that, she's going to get spoiled, and she's going to be like, oh, no, we're going for a walk? No, we're going for a put me on the ground. I will take a shit in the middle of the road, and then you will carry me home.
Yeah, I don't know how to discipline this dog. So, like, so the other morning, like you know, I'm sleeping. I got her on my stomach. You were gone. I'm sleeping, holding her. And then, like, I wake up. I have to go to work. So I put the dog down. She immediately starts crying. I'm like, okay, well, she'll knock this off eventually. I'll just ignore her. You know, I'll get my laptop out, do-do-do-do-do. She cries for like a solid hour.
Oh, my God.
Like, I'm on calls. I'm on Zoom. I'm trying to do shit. I'm trying to write copy. And she's just crying, crying, crying. And I think to myself, like, how do I make this stop? Do I hit her? Like, is this, like, am I supposed to hit this dog? I don't know how to discipline a dog.
I don't either. I definitely don't hit her.
I don't know what to do. Look, I didn't hit her. But it was the first thought to come to my mind. I'm like, I guess I'm supposed to hit her and shut her up. Like, I don't know. Maybe I'm not made out for this.
I mean, I heard that you're supposed to rub their face in their pee. But I don't know how do you rub your face in their cries?
I don't know. Maybe I rub their face in my pee?
Yeah. That's it.
I don't know what to do. Oh, my God. She is so fascinated by us going to the bathroom.
Yeah, it's weird.
I'm in the goddamn bathroom. I'm trying to take care of some business. She's scratching and clawing at the door. I'm like, okay, I'll let you in. She's like, great. And she's like, sits right in front of me. And she's like, this is like a fucking Fellini movie. She's like, this is like, watching you take a dump is like watching all 9 Star Wars movies. This is the most entertaining thing in the world.
Oh, yeah, no, she sits there and just stares at you with those creepy doll eyes.
Yeah, you've been saying that she has some sort of 1,000-yard stare.
She does. I don't understand what it is, but when you hold her and you pet her and the light shines just right, it looks like she's just got the 1,000-yard stare.
Yeah. Here's the thing. She's the runt. My mom told me she's the runt of the litter. So, like, she's always anxious and nervous. She thinks someone's going to steal her food all the time because, like, mm-hmm. I guess, like, her siblings stole her food. This dog's just got some problems. And, like, this dog, like, doesn't spend all this time, like, blaming themselves and going, like, oh, if you got more sleep and you drank more water and you went to the gym more, you wouldn't have anxiety and depression. Oh, if you budgeted better or fixed your diet or this or that. It's just like, she's just got like a little mental problem and you just got to pick her up and hold her.
Just hates doorbells. Just doesn't spend her time worrying about water intake or diet. Just licking her butthole.
She spends a lot of time doing that.
Every time I walk in on her, she's doing that.
The other thing she does a lot, cause like my little brother has a little homing device necklace on her. It's like a literal Apple AirTag that's in like a special dog necklace thing. She is constantly chewing and attacking it. Chewing and attacking and discarding the one thing that can help us find her when she eventually breaks out of this harness and runs away.
Yeah, she hates that Apple tag.
I think this dog wants to live off the grid. It's a libertarian dog.
She is. She clearly is.
This dog does not like big tech. This dog hates Section 231.
Hates big stairs.
Hates big stairs. Loves big cuddles. If there were any dog that would be super into crypto, it's this dog. Maybe we should change this name's dog to Crypto the Wonder Dog.
Or we can name it after. We could name her Chainlink or something.
Why don't we name her Shiba Inu?
Shiba Inu. For fuck you, Shiba Inu.
Wait, what's wrong with Shiba Inu?
I don't know. It's just stupid.
Can we name her Sushi? What's the worst named crypto?
Let's think. Ooh, Solana. That kind of sounds like a dog's name.
It's a little Solana.
Uniswap. Sushi Swap.
What do you think the word Lily means to her? Because, like, she doesn't know it's her name. Does it mean, like, come here? Does it mean I love you? Like, when we say Lily, what is she interpreting?
I think she knows that it means that you want her attention.
Yeah.
But I don't think she knows it as her name.
Yeah, I don't think so either. Okay, so we could change her name without fucking around too much. All right, actually, speaking of crypto... So, Sriracha, you are a regular subscriber to Cosmopolitan Magazine.
Yes. This month's top article, A Beginner's Guide to a Confusingly Smooth Butt, which I think is the weirdest way to, like, damn, bitch, this ass is confusing.
Confusing?
Damn, bitch, your ass is complex. Damn, this is problematic.
What a, the curves, the non-Euclidean curves of dead ass. Making me feel different.
Yeah, I don't know why they put that there, but I was so excited to see that there is a, you know how they have the little previews of the stories in here?
Yeah.
They have one. All right, fine, let's talk about crypto. Only, like, missed that bullet train by what, like 6 months?
No, like 4 years. Like, remember the first crypto run up, like when it hit 20? What was that, like 3 or 4 years ago?
Yeah, but that I meant like this year when all the normies were talking about it.
I mean, that's true. Yeah, so Cosmopolitan, who has Shakira on the cover and an article about ass smoothness, also. They're now getting into the crypto game.
Yeah, so I figured we could read this article together. First of all, this is the picture that they chose for the article, which I think is funny because I've done nothing but lose money with cryptocurrency.
Can you describe what that is?
It's an African-American woman, except her top half of her head is a goddamn pile of gold coins, like gold coins, that the kind that come wrapped in foil and you eat them, the chocolate coins.
Hanukkah gelt.
Yeah, whatever it's called. It says, your brain computing how long till you're a Novu Rish. Oh, by the way, Cosmo's thing, and I know I've seen the demographic. I know it's a sausage fest in here. So if you've never read an issue of Cosmo before, their whole thing is that they're boomers LARPing as like Gen Zers, yes, or millennials. And it's so transparent. You could absolutely tell. All right. So let's see. This is first, and also I'm upset because I didn't realize that there was a job, like Cosmo was recruiting for dumb bitch cryptocurrency writers, because that could have been me.
It still can be you.
That could have been me. Fuck you, Jessica Goodwin. Always a good sign. The first line in the article is, it's not you, it is confusing. That's what I want to hear from my experts.
Math is hard.
Math. What's the sluttiest cryptocurrency? All right. Remember back in April when it seemed like literally everyone was buying that elusive thing called Dogecoin to screw over Wall Street and also make bank by getting on a cryptocurrency? How did Dogecoin screw over Wall Street?
I don't think it did.
I think they're I seriously think they're confusing the GameStop shit.
Yes.
With Dogecoin because it happened to happen at the same time.
You are 1,000,000% correct.
But then, not everyone got rich, and some even lost, like, everything? Still, it's not weird to be very, very intrigued by the idea of becoming a Bitcoin billionaire, even if you're unclear on how any of it actually works. That's why we're here, to quell your FOMO with everything you need to know.
Still using FOMO, huh?
Yeah, uh-huh.
That word's still in the lexicon?
Time
that
to
word
stop.
Isn't... Shugi.
they use the word shugi in this fantasy game. It's time to stop. The crypto overlord is a computer. Let's dissect that for a minute.
Is that true?
I mean, my overlord is definitely a computer.
Can I pray and make offerings to this overlord?
Please, goddammit, Link, go up. Stop falling, you shitcoin. First, this kind of cash comes in the form of intangible digital units, aka you can't physically touch them, often called tokens or coins. You know the difference between a token and a coin?
I thought that was the same thing.
No.
What's the difference?
I'm pretty sure coins run on their own blockchain and tokens run on the Ethereum network.
Oh, okay. That makes sense.
It's like Bitcoin is a coin. Dogecoin is a coin too. Chainlink is a token.
Okay. Chainlink runs on the Ethereum network?
Sure shit does.
I didn't know that.
Unlike traditional paper money, they're not issued by a central bank, semicolon. Kind of like traditional paper money, there are a lot of different currencies out there, says Primavera DeFileppi, a faculty associate at the Berkman Klein Center for Internet and Society at Harvard University.
Primavera?
Her name is Primavera.
They couldn't get through to Ravioli Jones or Spaghetti Western or someone else?
Spaghetti Western. Oh my God, that's funny. In some cases, there's a set limited amount of a cryptocurrency in circulation. For example, there will only ever be 21 million Bitcoins in the world. Bitcoins. Bitcoins. That's my pet peeve. I see this all over the... Bitcoin and Bitcoin stock. I can't stand it.
You stopped and you gave me the gym look like I was supposed to know what was wrong with this. So far, I am unironically learning things from this article. What's the faux pas there? The crypto pas?
Bitcoin is plural already.
Oh, okay.
21 million Bitcoin. There's not 21 million Bitcoins.
Okay.
Ethereums.
Okay, thank you.
In other cases, like with Ethereum, there's no max on how many coins can be created by a currency's bank. Almost all crypto exchanges use their own version of something called blockchain software, which records who's buying and who's selling in a super hard to hack way. You can't use it like IRL money. False, I've bought so many drugs. Oh man, remember Silk Road? Remember when that was a thing? Do you ever get on Silk Road?
No.
I got in there once because Tor was a relatively new thing. This is going to really show my age, but Tor was a relatively new thing when I was in college. I was obsessed with the Tor network, and I got on Silk Road at one point, and it was all MDMA and people selling like Michael Jackson downloads of music, I assume, to people in China who can't get them.
Oh, okay. The thing about Silk Road that I never understood is like, well, how do you know someone's not just going to run away with your Bitcoin? Like, how can you guarantee these drugs? Is there some sort of like escrow? Held by a bigger mobster?
I never actually used it, but I remember there was like a review system or something. Like, you'd have to verify the transaction, and then you'd write. And then if you were just a new seller, I guess you're just SOL. Because I wouldn't buy my MDMA from a new seller.
Okay. I would always feel bad because, like, you know, if I ever hired a hitman and they ran away with my Bitcoin, like, that's very unethical of that hitman.
It's very unethical. I did buy Adderall once with Bitcoin.
You did?
Yeah, when I was in college, and it came in a box of Staples.
Well, if you had just started a podcast in college, someone would have mailed you a notebook full of Adderall.
I know. Fucking, I need to streamline my processes. I'm going to bet you 30 Dogecoins.
Which is what, like 30 cents?
$5 maybe. I think they're like a quarter.
They're worth a quarter?
Something like that, yeah.
To me, in my mind, Dogecoins are still worth like a half of a penny.
I know, right?
Wow. I didn't know Dogecoin kept some kind of value.
It shouldn't. It's just fucking Elon Musk, who, by the way, if I haven't gotten this rant enough in this podcast, Elon Musk is the fucking worst thing to ever happen to cryptocurrency. I hate him and I hope he dies.
I don't think you've ever ranted about Elon Musk on this show. No. You rant about it to me pretty much every weekend.
Okay, so Elon Musk is a dumb, stupid, dumbass idiot. Face in the toilet. I want to give him a swirly nerd. So Dogecoin, the only reason why Dogecoin is what it is because Elon Musk keeps fucking incessantly tweeting about it. There are an unlimited amount of Dogecoins in the world. There can be, like, a Dogecoin is just going to go forever. It doesn't do anything. It's a fucking meme. It's a joke. And it's now made people millionaires and then crashed and then I guess is back up again. Remember that time that somebody made that fake Litecoin article and published it and the price of Litecoin, where it said, they said like Walmart was going to make start accepting Litecoin.
We talked about it on this show.
And then the price of Litecoin spiked and then fell. Remember how that stupid bitch Yellen started talking about regulating crypto after that? Of course you don't, because no one cared, because Elon Musk didn't tweet about it. But as soon as he starts bringing attention to this shit, that's when everything is going to start getting regulated. When Elon Musk starts, because he is manipulating the market. He is. And have you seen these regulations that they want to try to put on cryptocurrencies? Half of them are literally impossible. They want like a record of every transaction that occurred on the Ethereum network because fucking boomers think that paper wallet addresses are like bank accounts. They can be associated with an identity. Like nobody knows what the fuck they're talking about. But this stupid, dumbass, idiot moron tweets about it and everybody with eyes can see that the price shoots up after he tweets about it. So then all these stupid, dumbass 90-year-old senators are like, oh, it must be a security then. We need to regulate it like a security, even though it meets absolutely none of the requirements for a security.
Look, all I know about Janet Yellen is this. I saw a Ben Garrison cartoon with Janet Yellen, and all her arms were like the tentacle arms of a squid, and all those arms were holding like magnifying glasses, and those squid arms were like going through your physical wallet and taking money out of it. They were spying on you, and those arms were trying to audit you. I had no idea that Janet Yellen was some sort of like interstellar alien who was super into breaking my financial privacy, but now I'm totally against her.
Right, and it was labeled fraud and IRS abuse. So every arm of the tentacle was labeled with something so you're not confused at all.
I mean, literally, I did not know it was Janet Yellen, but she had a name tag on that said Janet Yellen. Well, I was like, oh, I thought that was Newt Gingrich.
Janet Yellen's a dumb bitch. Anyways, I'm going to bet you 30 Dogecoins that your local coffee shop does not accept crypto. I went to a Lil Pump concert once, and he was accepting Bitcoin for t-shirts.
There are coffee shops around here that accept crypto.
Yeah, no, there's a place you can, like, buy Bitcoins. There's an ATM where you can buy Bitcoin.
Yeah, at the fucking taco shop across the street from where we live. Yeah. And that's been really confusing to me, because that is not a regular ATM that also dispenses Bitcoin. It's just for Bitcoin. And one time I needed cash quick, and I ran in there. I was like, God damn it. No, I don't need $50,000 worth of Bitcoin.
How to tell if your neighborhood is gentrified? Does your local taqueria have a Bitcoin machine in it?
Yeah. So I went to the bodega next door, which had a Bitcoin machine that also gave out 20s. And I was like, thank you, Christ.
God. Local Bitcoins. This episode is sponsored by localbitcoins.com. Meet up with a stranger and get your Bitcoins. But even if you did try to pay for your pumpkin spice latte with digital currency, it could take up to an hour to go through because the computers using blockchain have to work really effing hard to process payments, according to financial expert Humphrey Yang. Follow at Humphrey Talks ASAP. Trust. No, I don't think I will. Oh, and you'd have to pay not cheap processing fees. The gas fees are fucking insane right now.
What are they? I don't know.
Why Quackcoin can't. Quackcoin will never be until the price of Ethereum goes to the floor again.
If I want to send someone a dollar in Ethereum, how much was the processing fee?
I genuinely don't know because I don't think anywhere would let you send just a dollar of Ethereum.
Really?
Yeah, because the processing fee is that.
Oh, okay.
You have to gas the transaction. Oh, and you'd have to pay the not cheap processing fees. As newer forms of cryptocurrencies and updates to existing ones roll out, you might start seeing speedier transaction times. That's correct.
Oh, okay. That's great.
You should think of it as an investment.
Why are you... I don't know what the gym face means. Is it not an investment?
Cryptocurrency is an investment, like NFTs are an investment.
Well, it's speculation. You can invest speculatively. You can have a dumb, stupid investment.
You sure can.
You can invest in a SoundCloud rapper. You're probably not going to make a ton of money, but you can do it.
Like people who buy stock in buzzy new companies, many crypto investors snap up coins to hopefully make money over the very long term. I can confirm have done nothing but lost money on crypto.
Really?
No, I got in way early, though. Yeah. I'm like an original noob with this crap, though. So I think when everybody started buying it, I think a lot of people lost money. But damn, if I got this job, I could unload all my Statera bags. I'm just writing a whole article about it.
I think you could probably get a job as Cosmos Crypto Girl.
Oh, you really?
I genuinely do. I think, like, it would be a lot of what outfit we put on you. Like, if we put you in, like, kind of like a, like, let's say, like, a skin-tight kind of jumper, but instead of, like, dollar signs, it had, like, the crypto C, like, the Bitcoin B on it, and you had, like, a magnifying glass and a little pork pie hat. Cool sunglasses with like the Bitcoin B in them, you know, and like we could just call you like Little B or like Little Bit or like Little Bitty or something. Like if we could give you some kind of persona, we could send you to these crypto conventions and I think you would do well.
I think that job is already taken by someone named Shardy B.
Who?
On Twitter.
There's a Shardy B?
Shardy B, like shards of ether. Shardy B, don't follow Shardy B if you hate money. Anyway,
who the fuck are you ever talking? Okay, first off, that sounds a lot like Shardy B.
It does, doesn't it?
She should not have called herself that.
The rewards could be major, but take note, crypto is extremely volatile.
Now they're bringing this up? Now they're talking about its volatility?
Bitch, you could say that again. Says DeFilippia, mostly because its value isn't based on anything, well, real. I mean, what even is money?
Well, I mean, the dollar's not based on the gold standard anymore. I guess it's based on the idea that America won't go out of business, right?
Yeah, I mean, I guess. What even is the value of money based on? Is it like national? I don't understand economics.
I mean, right now, I think the value of our money is kind of based on the fact that, like, we got a lot of nuclear missiles. We'll be around for a while.
Okay, sounds good. At least not real in the way stock values are based on how IRL businesses perform.
But they're not based on how businesses perform. Like, Uber has not made a single dollar yet, but its stock price is through the roof.
Yeah, question mark. A cryptocurrency's value is based solely on what people are willing to pay for it in hopes that it'll become huge. So basically, don't invest any money that you're not prepared to lose, says Yang. If you do have enough cash to take risks, this is the one that really gets me. Apps like Venmo, Cash App, and Robinhood let you buy crypto on their platforms. You see, but the implication here is that these people that are reading this article are too boomer for Coinbase. Like they
That's true.
They need to buy it on Venmo. Who the fuck buys crypto on Venmo?
I guess it's, you already have Venmo and Cash App on your phone, probably.
I friggin' guess. Once you do, forget about it. Seriously, don't touch these coins for at least 5 to 10 years. That is good advice.
That is good advice.
The longer you hold it, the better. They missed a really good chance to put the word hodl in here. The longer you hold it, the better chance it has of doing well, says Yang. Partly because most investments work like that. And partly because experts think that the crypto world will stabilize, become more valuable over time. It's all fine to just chill for now. Listen, if you can swing it, buying coins isn't a terrible idea, assuming you follow the rules on this page. But if it all seems way too adventurous for your bank account right now, you don't have to get stuck in that FOMO spiral. Even seasoned financial advisors aren't sure what the future of crypto could look like. It looks like racist frog memes.
That's exactly what it looks like.
All the way down, all the way up to the moon. It's still pretty much the Wild West out there. If, instead, you want a solid, safer way to invest your cashola, put it in a 401k or other type of retirement savings, and you'll be just fine until the dollar collapses. We all have parts of our brain replaced with computers. And then we will pay for goods and services by looking at each other and exchanging Bitcoin. That's the end of the article, by the way. Oh, and then also there are three crypto biggies, which I think is funny that they left out the one that I think it's the third largest market cap, but it's the one that gases the Chinese unregistered exchange.
With the what?
Okay, so do you know what Binance is?
No!
All right, let's just move on.
Okay.
Three crypto biggies. Bitcoin, the most famous kind, has been around for 13 years. Its price at press time, $47,637 for one Bitcoin, is so high because of its limited supply.
It's up to 50. I saw it like 55 grand the other day.
Is it? I mean, yeah. it dumps and pumps like 10% within a week. So I don't blame them if this is wrong.
Yeah, but I mean, I just think it's crazy that it's worth 55 grand.
Ethereum. Founded in 2013, its blockchain works faster than Bitcoin's, so you can use it to buy non-fungible tokens or NFTs like digital art. Yeah, that's what that was made for.
I think the editor was like, you got to get an NFT in here somewhere.
Yeah, no, they definitely did. There was probably something about smart contracts here that they were like, nobody knows what that fucking is. Put the MFT thing.
Yeah, exactly. People have heard of that NFT thing.
And then their third choice, Cardano, at just $243 per coin. This one claims to have the most energy efficient blockchain in the game, which they all do. Did we learn something today? I hope we did, family.
Yeah, I mean, all I learned was I guess I should be investing in Cardano.
All I learned was that Jessica Goodman, I think, has an assload of Cardano she wants to unload.
What are you trying to unload again? Do you have like some terrible crypto?
Oh, I have so many terrible cryptocurrencies that I've like, for every chain, like there's a bunch of stinkers. My portfolio, I have a ton of The Graph, which I bought like at the absolute top. And then I have a bunch of SushiSwap.
No. You bought SushiSwap?
I think SushiSwap might be in the black on SushiSwap. I don't remember. I have hair comb, which is definitely in the toilet.
Hair comb?
I have Statera.
Okay.
I have a lot of crap.
All right. Well, how about this? How about when we do like our holiday merch sale this year? Each thing we sell will come with a small amount of a random cryptocurrency from your wallet.
Maybe. We'll see how much that has to cost to send.
Yeah, I don't know what the gas fees are. Okay, maybe we won't do that.
I am a quack coin billionaire. I do have 100% of the circulating supply, of which 0% is circulating.
Oh, my goodness. All right. Well, hey, thank you for... Look, I learned nothing. This is all I learned. There's something called Cardano out there.
Good
okay.
Job.
I might buy some Cardano. Fuck it.
Fuck it. Go for it.
I mean, the thing is, if what is this, Red Book? If Cosmo's writing about it, that it's something that is becoming popular with normies. So maybe I could buy a bunch of Cardano now and then have even more normies holding the bag.
I think I would bet that they pick Cardano because go on coinmarketcap.com.
Okay.
I'm going to bet it's like top five. But also in the top five is going to be Binance Coin, which is the coin that is issued by Binance, the largest cryptocurrency exchange in the world that we are now banned from because we are Americans. You can buy it on Binance US, but Binance US sucks.
Okay, so I'm on Bitcoin News. Cardano slips to fifth largest crypto market position, down 30% since all-time high last month. Okay, maybe I'm a little bit late in this. Gene Simmons' $300,000 Cardano investment has more than doubled since February. Gene Simmons from KISS.
Everybody's making money on crypto, guys. You got to FOMO in.
Terrible musician, excellent investor. Regardless, really long tongue. Good job, Gene Simmons. All right. Gene Simmons says, I like Cardano, although it's an idiot's name. Get rid of that thing. Just call it ADA. Call it by the trading name. Gene Simmons has like very specific opinions about cryptocurrency.
What's wrong with the name Cardano?
I don't know, but the bassist from KISS doesn't like it.
Well, man, the bassist, this must be the bassist from KISS first time at the fucking rodeo, because there's some stupid ass crypto names out there.
I wonder what the star child or the cat man thinks of sushi swap.
Pancake swap.
Pancake swap. All right. Well, hey, we'll be right back after this with some Chicago party ant talk.
And the Fat Caps. And Niko.
Niko and the Fat Caps are going to be here, and they're going to be bringing brats and sausages and, oh, pierogies.
You bring the Cardano.
Let's drink some Malort. We'll be right back, okay?
Bye.
Welcome back to the Loudest Podcast. Sriracha sent me an urgent text over the weekend. Sriracha,
First of all, I don't know who this Sriracha person is. My name is Officer Grant, and I'm the Chicago party man. With me is Kevin and Niko. Guys, howdy ho. How you doing?
Hey, Dare, how are you?
Hey, Dare, da bears.
Da bears.
Okay, now, listeners, you might be confused. Sriracha... And actually, the world is taken with a new show on Netflix. No, not Squid Games. It's Games could go to hell. There's this show called Chicago Party Ant. There's 8 episodes of it. It's like an animated series just on Netflix about like a woman in her 40s to 50s, and she's just like an alcoholic Chicagoan.
She's irritating as fuck, and this whole show is about her and her gay nephew start living together.
Put a little less sauce on the word gay.
Okay, her and her gay nephew.
Yes, exactly.
Her and her gay nephew, Daniel, who she gives up his acceptance to Stanford to get underage drunk in his aunt's apartment all summer.
I mean, that's pretty much the show. Like, that's the premise of the show. It's just a teenager and an alcoholic party aunt living together in the city of Chicago. And, of course, we had to reach out to our own Chicago party aunt, Niko, and our Chicago party uncles, Grant and Kevin. Thank you guys for coming on the show.
Absolutely. I resent that. Full-heartedly, I resent that.
I'm a party uncle. I'm not afraid to say it. I don't have a niece or a nephew, but at Spirit, I am.
I'm afraid I'm going to be this woman because I see parts of myself in her.
Oh, like, you already are this woman.
Oh, fuck you. Go to hell.
It seems like the Chicago party yet doesn't have any taste in music. So I think Nico's already one step
ahead. Yeah, and like, in what fucking universe where I'd be like, I love going to Wrigleyville. Maybe if you like getting like roofied, like
your favorite radio station is 97.9 The Loop. It perfectly matches up.
I don't know what that is, because I've only lived in Chicago for 2.5 years, and like a year and a half of this, like, COVID's been a thing, so I exactly haven't been able to be a party aunt.
You have a big crush on Man Cow.
I don't know any of this people
and,
are.
And listeners, you'll notice, like, they're making a lot of specific Chicago references. Like, are these references funny? No, absolutely not. But are they referencing things from Chicago? Yes.
The bean.
And that's the entire premise of the show, Chicago Party Ant. Let's list the things Sears that Tower. Are in Chicago. Sears Tower?
Willis Tower.
It opens Chief with Keith. The bean?
Literally, the bean is the first thing in the opener that you see. She's like, "That you remember that time that cow kicked that lantern down and everything burned?" Neither do we. Welcome to Chicago.
Wait, did you guys know about that or did you learn something from the show?
I've learned a lot from this show. It's just they're not jokes. Like she'll right. she'll be like, "Oh, in Chicago, we don't put ketchup on our hot dogs." And like, well, thanks. Thanks for the information. But
yeah, now you learned something.
I don't even like hot dogs. I'm like not like, I'm not a Chicago party aunt. First of all, this show should be called Chicago Party Mom because she has a fucking kid who's like I don't know. Are they trying to say he's like slow in the brain or something?
Like a little bit, yeah. That was established. Like he got hit in the head so many times that now he's slow in the mind.
So he's just because he's like slow in the mind. She's like, I'm not a mom. I'm an aunt. Like what?
Well, it's centered on
you can be both.
Yeah, it's centered upon the dynamic between Chicago party aunt and her gay nephew.
Again, really no reason to put that much mustard on it. Oh, and there's a lot of talk of mustard in this goddamn show. There's a whole episode that takes place at like a ribs eating festival. Do you guys go to some rib festival?
Yeah, it's called Rib Fest and it's in Naperville.
Shut up.
So well, they have like no, Taste of Chicago here. I don't know if that's what they're
there's
going
like
for.
Restaurant week or whatever.
No, well, because they called it Rib Fest in the episode, and there is a Rib Fest, and it is in Naperville, and they do get like big musical acts and shit. Like, I don't think that was one of the things that they were hamming up.
Some of these big New York City folks, they don't really give a shit how accurate it is. Matter of fact, they look down on us.
I mean, we do. You're the second. You are second to us. But here's the thing.
Yeah, but you guys are basically subtropical because of global warming. So, you know.
I mean, what I'm saying is.
We'll see in about a decade.
Hey, if we're going to start insulting New York, I have a whole list of things that I can say, but let's stay focused.
Go ahead. You could write an entire episode called New York Party Again. Here's my episode idea. Ready? Yankees and Red Sox don't like each other.
Yeah,
that's the joke. Go through the Wikipedia.
The whole time we were just like, hey, I'm Bronx party aunt over here. Don't go on. Don't take the one past 96th Street. Hey, look, we love dollar slices. Oh, and it's like these aren't jokes. It's just we do have dollar slices here, but you don't need to put that on Netflix.
Times Square smells like piss.
In New York City, Los Angeles, you guys get everything. God forbid we get one animated program and you learn something. You learn we're a mustard city.
So are you saying you're proud of this show, Kevin?
We also have Mission Hill, which kind of, the show is like a shit version of that.
Mission Hill is a hodgepodge from, according to the Wikipedia article.
You can't have Mission Hill because it takes place in Boston.
It was based off of Wicker Park.
Yeah. Let us just have this. God, it's like...
All I can say is the difference between the two is that Mission Hill was like, oh, an up-and-coming animator and his annoying brother move in with these weird people, and it's like Chicago Party Aunt is the title.
It's so much, and Asterios think this show is as ugly as Mission Hill. I think this is significantly uglier.
Asterios, what the fuck is your
Mission
problem?
Mission Hill is not ugly. Mission Hill is, I think, one of the best-looking American animated programs there is.
Asterios, you're so wrong.
A striking
How
visual
the fuck
style.
Is Mission Hill ugly? It's called aesthetic.
It looks like an indie comic brought to life.
Right. Yeah, no one wants that. There's a reason nobody buys Dan Clough's comics.
Because people have shit taste. And
it came out, it was ahead of its time.
Literally. You need a certain level IQ to understand Mission Hill.
Yeah, sorry he doesn't turn into a pickle in this one.
Yeah, or says, I'm Urkel, or whatever the fuck Urkel says. I don't know.
Actually, that's a good point. You brought up Urkel. Hey, he's from Chicago.
He's from Chicago.
Yeah, Urkel doesn't put his Chicago-ness in your face. He doesn't wear it on his sleeve. Oh, my God.
Fair.
In the fucking pilot, when the moment I turned the show off and I was like, I do not want to watch any more of this, was the argument they had where the sister was like, you're just like Chicago. You're past your prime. You're fucked up. You're an alcoholic and nobody loves you. And she's like, I am like Chicago. I'm an underdog. And it's like, I get that you're both like Chicago, but I don't care about either of you. This fucking show. Okay, first off, I looked it up. Mission Hill is actually a combination of Mission Hill in Boston, the Mission District in San Francisco, Silver Lake in Los Angeles, and Wicker Park in Chicago.
So how was I ever supposed to fucking guess that when it's called Mission Hill, which is literally a neighborhood in Boston?
I mean, but there doesn't San Francisco have the Mission District?
I don't know.
I'm just saying, but speaking of Mission Hill, Bill Oakley, creator of Mission Hill, writes for this shitty show.
Yes, he
that
does.
We all got on the phone to make fun of. So I'm not, you fucking Mission Hill fanboys, this is your fucking fault.
Well, did he draw this? Because I hope not.
I cannot be silent anymore, and I have to speak my truth. I didn't hate this show. I didn't dislike this show. I actually kind of liked it a little bit. And I'm not kidding. I'm not saying it was perfect. It was a little bloated. All right.
Just
maybe
like
the fan service.
Yeah, it's just like the Chicago Party Ant's ass.
That's what I'm saying.
Personally, I hated it. I hate the Chicago Party Ant. I hate the gay kid, whatever his name is.
Look, we've talked about how much okay. we hate the show for 20
because
minutes.
He's what?
I want to hear.
Gay or a kid?
I want to hear what you like about this show.
I would be lying, and I'm ashamed to admit this. I would be lying if I said that some of the pandering didn't get through to me, because it reminded me of, like, I have a lot of extended family who it was basically exactly like that, the Rib Fest episode with, I don't know, just like...
Probably talking about the tailgate episode.
I'm sorry, the tailgating episode. Yeah, that one, I feel like that one, I was like, oh, this is like a familiar thing to me. And I would say, like, I think some of the joke writing was pretty funny. Sure, like, yeah, they went a little overboard. I know they had, like, the Andy Richter cameo, celebrity cameo. I don't know if you guys got that far, but that's, you know, for the real heads out there who binged it all... You'll know what I'm talking about.
They name dropped Yorkville.
They did, yeah. How exciting is that?
Kevin, man, your brain's broken. I'm sorry. Yeah. What's wrong with you? Your brain's broken if you laughed at
you name drop a few Chicago suburbs, like, I just fucking soy out.
You see this? This is how thirsty people in Chicago are for any type of representation that they...
I'll back Kevin up a little bit and say I didn't hate it, but I feel like because there's no more room in my heart for hate, it's like I turned it on and the first episode's just this barrage of unfunny references, and I was like, yeah. Like there were some moments.
Grant, I know you and I have been familiar with the Twitter account that this is based on, which I know that there was a lot of hate from people's, oh, I have more followers in that account. Why didn't I get a Netflix show? It's because you're not interesting. You don't have, not even not interesting, you don't have a gimmick. Like, ever since we've been doing Thought Cops, even, we've, like, jokingly tweeted that Chicago Party, and we'd sometimes get a little comical back and forth, you know,
I'm
have a little fun.
She never agreed to come on the show, but.
Well, because
I'm
she doesn't exist, apparently.
She's also a man.
She's a man named, like, Chris Witke or something, who also has created other television shows. Like, this isn't, like, some rags-to-riches thing where, like, a nobody with a Twitter... Like,
right,
this guy clearly created a Twitter account because he was like, yeah, I bet I could get this into a TV show. Like, the shit my
Maybe.
Dad says Twitter account.
Yeah, maybe not, though. Maybe not, though. Like, God forbid... So, Asterios, if somebody works in television, they're not allowed to have a Twitter account because just in case it gets a TV show or success from it, people will call them out for astroturfing?
Literally nobody said that.
Right, at least the guy grew up in, like, the suburbs.
What, are we all standing up for the oppressed television writer? I mean, I will say this.
No.
Every single person
nobody
on
is.
This show has a deep connection to Chicago. Ike Barinholtz and his brother, they both mm-hmm. write for it. Bob Odenkirk plays the guy. Jill Talley, like, Chicago comedy legend. Like,
yeah.
I get that this is like a wall-to-wall show of Chicagoans. I just don't care. I feel like this show is only for people who live in Chicago. It's like, just air it in Chicago. How about this? VPN gate it. So it only airs in Chicago. So the rest of us don't have to put up... Oh my god, all these stupid references. Like,
yeah, I mean, it probably should have stayed on WGN, maybe.
Yeah, if this aired on WGN and only inside Wrigley Stadium, I think it would be much more successful.
But that's not why they made this show, because they're trying to sell the show to other people.
But then they need to sell something better.
Asterios, what if they made a show about another oppressed class of people? And they would say, oh, this is only they should watch it. You know, keep it away from me. You would be canceled for what you're saying.
Chicago comedian, the most oppressed
compared to New Yorkers, we are.
The race literally, of Chicagoans.
You literally
hey, we can say Second City. You can't say Second City.
And on the topic of Second City, that's actually something I did want to bring up because you mentioned Chicago humor. And I will say that, like, when I first started to get involved in the Chicago comedy scene, like, back, I don't know, in the early 2010s or whatever, I was turned off because I was kind of checking out Second City improv shows just to kind of feel it out and stuff. And I hated it. Like, it was all like, oh, I took the red line. I saw the Cubs. I got my law. You know, it was all like, it did really feel like these people weren't actually funny. They were just referencing Chicago stuff. And I guess...
Yeah,
kind of
reminds
me
of a certain sitcom we're talking about right now, right?
It does, Asterios, it does, but I would say, like, at least it was funny enough to carry that for me personally. Like, whereas these improv people, it was literally just that. Just references and people coming from the suburbs to be like, oh, they're talking about Chicago, you know? Yeah. So this felt like there was at least, like you said, there's some you know, Odenkirk, Oakley, some big people on here who are actually funny and talented, who can carry it. But I will say, like, as far as that being a criticism, that's valid. You're valid for saying this.
Did you guys fucking jizz every time they said Malort? Like, they say Malort in several episodes. Were you guys like, oh, finally.
Oh, hands-free orgasm.
I think that, like, some of the more visual continuity was a little more appealing to me. And, that, like, this is... maybe sort of where you can draw the line between me and Kevin is because, like, a lot of the references I thought were, like, pretty fucking stupid, but, like a lot of times when they would have, like, a setting that was, like, the Field Museum, I'd be watching it, like, very intensely to be
right.
Like, did they walk into the right room? Like, there's no car, there's no, like, a driveway that goes in front of that building. Like shit like that. Like,
and Grant, you were a dude from Chicago. You would
but
know.
That's not good enough to carry an entire show in and of itself.
Oh, I know that feeling, though, because I watch those fight videos in New York metro stations, and I feel a spark of joy when I can recognize the station that the
right.
people are fighting in.
But I'll say this, that it's entertaining to watch people fight. Like, what Grant is saying is he's like, yes, these are very accurate representations of Chicago.
That
it's
was
like,
the most
know,
I got out
you
of
know,
it.
It's like, I could read the Wikipedia page for Chicago. Like, I'm looking to be entertained. Okay,
but cartoons are funny.
Let's put aside the fact that, like, okay, it's this show exists to suck Chicago's dick. That's fine. It's also, like, weirdly sad. For a show called Chicago Party Aunt, which you expect to be about, like, a hard-partying, crazy Chicago lady having crazy adventures, there's an episode where she has to deal with the fact that her dad is dying. There's an episode where she visits her ex-husband at the hospital. Like,
I think they're trying to go with, like, the BoJack angle.
That's yeah. what I thought. Yeah. I only watched two episodes. I'm like, oh, they're gonna go, like, but actually, she is a party animal because she's sad inside, and I'm just like, don't care.
They don't lean too hard into that, like BoJack, though, or like even like Rick and Morty. They do steer a little bit further away, but yeah, they do touch into that area a little bit for sure.
Yeah, there's an episode where there's like a C-plot where like two characters are like, should we turn our kids' room into a gym now that our kid's going to college? And it's like, I don't know. I don't care. Why are you showing me this?
Asterios, I will say the B-plots and C-plots were not great. They felt like, that's another thing I want to say. Half the cast...
The A-plots weren't great.
half the cast felt extraneous. I won't lie. Like, I didn't really care about what Daniel's parents were doing.
At all.
It felt like... They
His
were kind
mom
of going,
was an annoying cunt.
They were kind of going for the Rick and Morty angle, like, what is, like, Morty's parents up to kind of thing, you know?
Oh, yeah, the dad really did have a Jerry vibe, too.
Exactly,
that I think about it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Listen, I'm not saying I love the show, but I'm saying it's not as bad as a lot of people
it's
are saying.
It's not Big Mouth, which
think
is just
as
like
bad. But I think it's just like not like I felt nothing watching it. The best I could feel was like during the Chicago Marathon episode, which I happened to watch the day of the Chicago Marathon, which was pretty surreal. And having ran the Chicago Marathon, that was a lot less painful than watching the show. But like I was sitting there watching, just like, oh, they're here, they're at the river, they're running here, they're there, and it's just like, okay, they just animated the setting really well.
Why don't you just look out the fucking window if you want to see Chicago so badly?
Well, that's what I'm saying, is like that's where my mind was going. It's just like it all just washed over me. It just felt like nothing. Like I can't even fully like get enraged about it because I just care about it so little that I can't say I like it. I can't even say that I hate it. I don't feel anything, Asterios. I need help.
This, I just need two things. Okay, there was one joke that made me laugh. It was like, she went to like that hipster coffee place and like, oh, we have a CBD drink. And she was like, reefer without, that can't get you high. What's the fucking point? And I was like, yes, exactly. What is the fucking
and
point?
And I liked the dynamic she had with the other people at the hair cutting place. Like, there were some funny character moments throughout the whole show. And I will say the elephant of the room that nobody's touched on the whole time, and this is the biggest criticism and probably the reason that people want to hate it the most, is the way it looks, okay? It doesn't look great. It's
incredibly ugly.
It's just like the Rick and Morty stasis kind of thing.
They're clearly students of the McFarlane School of Animation. Everything looks kind of like they got the Family Guy eyes, the Family Guy face.
I am happy that they did not give them the Big Mouth eyes, though.
God. Oh, thank God.
Big Mouth eyes look like fucking taxidermy, like dead animals.
And did I see a text message surround here where you said that Big Mouth looked like Citizen Kane compared to this?
Yeah, no.
All right, speaking of the art style, I will agree that Mission Hill at least has like some character to it. Think this art style actually kind of reminds me more of Clone High, where it looks like they had $8.
And I'm not a fan of how that show looks.
Yeah.
Me neither.
I mean, but at least people seem to, like, I've never really gotten into Clone High. People seem to really like it. I mean, I like the Lego movie. I think that's the only thing and I like Solo.
The Lego
too.
Movie kicks ass.
Yeah, you shouldn't apologize. That movie is awesome.
Well, no, it's just because the Clone High guys made the Lego movie. You know.
Oh, I didn't know that.
The Clone High guys made the Lego movie, and they also made Solo, but the screenwriter for Solo got so upset that they kept improvising that they fired the Clone High guys that they brought in Ron Howard. It's kind of ugly. Here's all I can say. Like, I appreciate that there's a show on the air where there's like a 40 to 50 year old alcoholic woman is the main character. The only other show I can think of like that is Roseanne.
I was just gonna say,
yeah, Roseanne's not an alcoholic though. Oh my God,
Roseanne,
I'm sorry to like go off.
Pills.
I'm sorry to go
she
off.
Took pills
I'm sorry
and then
to go.
Died. What do you mean Roseanne's not an alcoholic?
Okay, so like I watched the Roseanne reboot. And, you know, the first season, you know, like, she was alive, and there was that whole plot about her being a pillhead or whatever. And then, she, you know, she had her Ambien accident, and then they just fucking killed her off the show. And it's, like, they only mention it in the first episode, and it's so funny how they bring it up, because, like, no one really seems to care except Dan, because it's, like, her little grandkids are like, sure sad that Grandma Rosie died. It's like, damn,
Cue
like,
laugh,
no
Frank.
One cares except Dan. He's the only one who gives a fuck, and, like, after that, it's just like, never bring her up. And they change the show to the Connors.
Here's another interesting point, though. Didn't Roseanne take place in Chicago?
It's like the suburbs of Chicago.
Yeah.
Well, still, but it's like, you look at some of these great TV shows. You got Roseanne. You got the Steve Urkel Show, whatever that's called.
One-fourth of Mission Hill.
You got
25%.
Wasn't Married with Children was also, I mean, there was the big shot of Buckingham Fountain.
I mean, not to mention all the comedic talent that's come out of this city, like Jim Belushi, Bob Odenkirk, Aaron Klopfer,
Kanye West.
I'm talking about specifically the TV shows all took place in Chicago and had like a very sort of Chicago aesthetic, but didn't but didn't have anything to do with shoving down Michael Jordan and fucking Coach Ditka and Da Bears and Doc Hubs and the fucking Sears Tower and Millennium Park and The Bean and Wicker Park and Up Down and fucking the South Side and the fucking Comiskey Park and all these different places. They didn't have to fucking jam them with references. It's just like, oh, Married with Children. Hey, there's Buckingham Fountain. Let's tell some jokes.
They're trying to do a thing where they're like, oh, Chicago's like a character. Chicago is like a member of the cast in this show. And it's like, yeah, Chicago's a really shitty character in your shitty TV show. Like, this is watching. Like,
watch it, man. I'm like on your side. I wasn't a fan of the show, but hey.
I hate their asses too. I hate the hips on the main characters.
Dude, yeah, she has a dump truck. Like, she got little bit of the fupa. Like, wow.
Oh, she does make a little bit of an off color joke in the, I think, around the first episode where she's like,
fuck my cooter or some shit.
Well, no, like, she says like, North side, not so bad, looking pretty good. South side, not so great, pretty bad. And it's like,
I wonder why, dumb white bitch.
Right, right.
Got her ass, literally.
Question I wanted to ask you three. Do people in Chicago say anywho as often as they do on this show?
Older people. Like, I had, like... And that's the thing, like, the Chicago accent is not as prevalent as it used to be. Because, like, I've read an article about this once. It was, like, kind of like a... more of a working class kind of thing. Like, I had like a lot of, like, my grandpa talk like that, my great uncle and my great aunt
talk like that.
I'm
not from Chicago. I'm from Milwaukee, so I have no opinion except, like, I get clocked as not from Chicago because of how I say bag.
There you go. But, like, you remember, like, you guys remember Homestar Runner?
Yes. Yeah.
You remember the character Coach Z?
Yes.
Like, I gotta get a gerb. That's like Chicago accent, like. Because I remember, I'm like, that guy sounds like my uncle.
See, I've been just doing my Minnesota accent, and I think I sound really, really good, but I guess that it's clockable from here.
All right, we're going to close off by seeing who can do the best impression of the Chicago party aunt. Sriracha, would you like to go first?
I'm the Chicago party aunt, and I'm here with Niko. Let me tell you, my vagina's on fire.
I'm the Chicago party aunt. I'm not even from Chicago. I'm from the suburbs of Milwaukee, specifically the one where Liberace and Jeffrey Dahmer were born, but I am what they call a transplant, so I'm basically a Chicago native. My cooter. I'm drunk. I love Wrigleyville and hot dogs and deep dish pizza, which apparently people can stomach, and I'm done. I can't. This show is just very much like a cautionary tale of, like, don't be like this in 15, 20 years.
Y'all be idolizing the wrong people.
Yeah, I'm like, kind of the reason why I was like,
it's like Breaking Bad.
I was like, ooh, I see a little bit of myself in that. I need to not.
I'm the Chicago party aunt. You can shine my bean anytime.
Did they make that joke?
No, but...
How have they not made a flick my bean joke? Like, seriously, that's like... So, I would have expected them to make that.
So. Yeah.
All right, cool, Grant. What's your Chicago party aunt?
Millennium Park, Navy Pier, Lincoln Park Zoo, Art Institute of Chicago, Shedd Aquarium... The Field Museum, Chicago River Walk,
woo!
Museum of Science and Industry, Maggie Daly Park. I Googled list of Chicago things.
Grant, I feel like
Skydeck Chicago.
I'm the Chicago party aunt, and my pussy smells worse than the Shedd Aquarium.
It smells worse than a deep dish jardinera with Malort sprayed all over it, and Michael Jordan and Coach Ditka and fucking Bill Murray all shit on it.
The only thing deeper than a Pizzeria Uno is my camel toe.
I feel like some of these might have been jokes in the show.
They were. There was something about a camel toe. Okay, there was a joke about her, like, going in existential dread moving to Indiana, which, yes.
That was funny. That was kind of funny.
Yeah, that's just factual.
That was a good joke.
Like, going from Chicago to Indiana, I would, like, want to end it, so.
My pussy's more crammed than a red line car at 2 a.m. on a Friday night.
You want to see a red line? You got to see me before I go to the free clinic.
There we go.
Yeah, there was an abortion joke in there, so yeah, ooh.
There was a moment during one episode when they were all at the field museum, and the gay kid took a bite of Andy Richter's pot brownie, and he was like high off of his mind in the field museum and freaking out, and I was like, this is my nightmare come to fruition. Like, that would be
one bite.
If I was all fucked up and like high off my fucking balls in the field museum, I would be shitting my pants.
Why? It's fun.
Because it's haunted, okay? They have all those mummies. It's fucking haunted.
No, we don't.
Maybe if you're a pussy.
Place. We don't call it haunted anymore. We call it a liminal space.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Maybe if you're a pussy, I think it would be a fun time.
I did discover this show while high, and I made my friends watch two episodes of it, and then they literally wrestled the remote out of my hand to turn it off.
Don't you guys like Big Bang Theory?
Yeah, I don't.
But the big, Big Bang Theory, you could ignore.
Dude,
it. Like you can't ignore this loud, awful show. It's like it's offensive in every sense.
The Big Bang Theory isn't,
with the laugh track between every line.
Yeah, the laugh track sounds like a white noise machine.
When it's playing constantly.
Yeah, the Big Bang Theory is like, it's
I didn't know you guys were Big Bang Theory defenders. Okay, like, I was like,
we're talking about how it's like so inoffensive. It's easily ignored.
I'm the Chicago party uncle, and I live in Chicago, but I grew up in Chicagoland, aka the suburbs.
You sound like John Wayne Gacy.
I can't help that.
No wonder he got so close to people. He sounds so affable. I would trust that guy. Niko, I want to give you the last word here. Do you have any closing thoughts on Chicago party aunt or aunt? I don't know how you
just
Chicago
like,
would say it.
We say aunt here.
Aunt. I say aunt.
I say aunt.
Aunt. I say aunt. I don't know. I feel like I'm like not the best person to ask about if this is authentic Chicago or not, because I'm like not from Chicago. I'm from Milwaukee. Now, if they make Milwaukee's,
that's why you didn't like it.
Yeah,
and maybe if they made Milwaukeean stoner.
Was the TV show How to Make a Murderer kind of like your Joker?
It's so funny because like a lot of that family just reminds me of some of my cousins and uncles, so I'm like, I don't know if it's like a good thing, but
it's definitely not.
Wait, you like Milwaukee? Did you like that 70s show?
That's not in Milwaukee. That show is hilarious, but that's actually not in Milwaukee. They're like, I think like they're near Kenosha, like maybe because the town they're in is called Point Pleasant, so I'm thinking it's like Pleasant Prairie it's supposed to take place. It's like they're in between Milwaukee and Chicago because they talk about like, oh, we're gonna be going to Kenosha, like it's a big fucking deal, like Kenosha isn't a complete like festering shithole. There's like an episode where they make a big deal going to Chicago. I think they go to Milwaukee to party, so like, yeah, I'm a fan of that 70s show. That's a way better show than this, not even a piece of shit. It's just like
sounds like I'm changing some minds tonight.
It's just like, I don't know. I feel like what main, like it's just like,
well, I think you're one slice short of a deep dish.
It doesn't offend me as much as like, I don't know, like Big Mouth or the Cleveland Show, but like again, that's like not a compliment. That shit is just way worse.
Wait, if you like Milwaukee, do you like the Drew Carey Show?
Oh, that's not Milwaukee.
That's Cleveland.
And also, I didn't.
That was
I didn't,
the theme song is Cleveland Rocks.
I don't know. Look, if it's not New York, I don't. Honestly, I don't.
Asterios, you're the TV like sitcom expert.
Yeah,
I figured
what the fuck? Also, I didn't say I like Milwaukee. I said I'm from Milwaukee. There's a big difference.
But with the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
That's in Cleveland.
I don't know. I don't know where.
I went to it like 2 months ago. It's in Cleveland.
Until this point, I'm not kidding, I thought Milwaukee and Cleveland were the same thing. I'm like, Cleveland, you know, Haas and Pfeffer Incorporated. We're going to do it.
Well, Asterios, you like The Sopranos, right? Because that takes place in New York.
Isn't that New Jersey?
That's the joke.
Did I walk into the joke?
Same thing for it. We don't give a shit.
Yeah. Well, guys, I want to thank you guys for coming on. Now, the three of you specifically, you're going to be on an episode. You're recording a new episode of Thought Cops this week. When's that episode going to drop?
That's right. That'll be out.
Tuesday,
October 19th.
Yeah.
If all goes according to plan, maybe Wednesday, October 20th. But it'll be out that week.
No later than Thursday.
If you guys still have regular wall calendars, like you don't look at the calendar on your phone, put a big old red circle on that date and count down the days, because it's going to be a real barn burner.
Mm-hmm. Are you guys going to talk about, or have you already talked about Chicago Party?
We have a plan to talk about that actually for our spinoff podcast, Fire Bros, which you can check out if you go to patreon.com/thoughtcops. We'll be reviewing that.
It's only $2.
We'll have our friend Sleep Science on that one. Maybe Niko, if you want to come on that one too.
You're talking about Spree, right? Finally.
I don't even know what we're doing on the next, but we're doing Chicago Party on for sure. So yeah, check it out, and then of course check out Thought Cops wherever great podcasts are found and located.
Because Sorocha calls me and she's like, "There's this show." She's high out of her mind. She's like, "We're all watching this show called Chicago Party Ant." I thought it was about a literal little tiny ant, like from the movie Ants or A Bug's Life, who like had parties in Chicago. And then when I...
That's a much better show.
That's the thing. And then when I finally see the show, and it's just about this like very sad lady having very sad...
Oh, God forbid we have a strong woman lead.
Yeah, we need more like messy bitches, but like ones that are like fun. Like not like...
She's a party ant. Yeah, that's fun.
No, it's just very depressing.
That's the thing. It's like if she had had fun adventures partying all like rock and rolling all night and partying every day, that would have been great. Instead of like the second episode, there's a whole thing where she undergoes corporate training and it's like, oh, great. Now I do, too. Now I, the viewer, have to watch you watch a corporate training video with a bunch of references to Jerry Ferrara. Guess what? I know who Jerry Ferrara is. Sriracha doesn't. Neither of us found it funny. If you know who Jerry Ferrara is, it doesn't make it better.
Who is he?
Here's where I'm sort of disagreeing with you. Here's where I'm sort of disagreeing with you, though, Asterios, is that, like, the character, I do understand that the character is a certain type of person that back in her heyday used to be crazy and wild and now is just sort of a shell of her former self. Like, I feel like that maybe is a very specific Chicago experience, that we all know someone that has that haircut that listens to 97.9 The Loop and listens to, you know, Monday is Led Zeppelin Day. Get the
exactly.
And they, like, we know people that are like that, that are just sort of like shells of their former selves that like talk about the good old days and now are stuck in some sort of like shitty corporate job. That's not really the part of the show that I took any issue with.
You go to any dive bar in Chicago, you'll find at least one or two.
If I want to watch a show about like an aging alcoholic person who keeps making references nobody likes, I could just look in the mirror. Like, I'm turning on Netflix for fun.
Asterios, I would love to watch a cartoon about you, and I'm not kidding. I would love it.
You're basically a cartoon character.
Yeah, your voice is very cartoony.
You wouldn't even need to animate it.
Artie Grab, if you're listening, get this happening.
Okay, guys.
We were actually doing impersonations of you, like before we were recording.
Let's hear those. Let's close on that.
I think I might upset my neighbors, but here we go. How can you say that? Urkel was the main character of the show.
He's not a member of the family. It's weird that it's called Family Man. It should be called Urkel Matters.
It's called Urkel Matters because Urkel is the main character. How are they going to call it something else?
The
Goku?
The Ox King from the Dragon Ball Z English dub.
It's your voice.
I just get that guy.
I mean, ironically, the family doesn't matter in that show. Urkel does. Here's and he's not a member of the family. Yes?
Here's my impression of you, right? But he's on all the episodes. That's you. That's what you sound like.
All I want is for there to be one episode that has Stefan Urkel, Urkelbot, and Steve Urkel in it. And if they could get the evil puppet Steve-el in it, that would be great too.
What if in season 2 of Chicago Party Amp they have a cameo appearance by Jaleel White?
What if they just put him in the show and got rid of everyone else and just made it an Urkel cartoon? That would actually be great, because he can go on adventures. He builds robots. He goes into space in the finale. He drinks a potion and becomes a kung fu master. It's called Bruce Juice. And he does a flawless Bruce Lee impression. It's like, yeah, this guy's bringing some zazz. This lady is a snooze.
She went on adventures. They went to the gay bar Roscoe's in Boys Town.
Yeah, that episode where she accidentally outed her friend. It's like, oh, how much fun. Oh, this is great. I get to watch one cartoon character accidentally out another cartoon character to their elderly mother. What a great time I'm having on Netflix.
Peter Griffin does all sorts of horrible things, and guess what? We all love him anyway for it.
Yeah, he fights that chicken. That's pretty funny. I like that. When he hurts his leg, he hurts his leg for a long time. I like that.
Remember quite a while.
He beat the shit out of Donald Trump, and then Donald Trump wasn't the president anymore. What did Peter Griffin thank for that?
Oh my God! Have you guys seen the Trump guy episode? Because if not, like, you need to dedicate a whole episode to dissecting this because there is enough content for that.
Well, guys, thank you so much for coming on, and don't forget next Tuesday. You're listening to this on a Wednesday, so this coming Tuesday, actually, there's going to be a great episode of Thought Cops with Niko and the Thought Cops. Those are my favorite episodes of Thought Cops.
Me too.
I love it. She's fantastic. Thank you guys so much, and we'll be right back after this with more of the Loudest Podcast.
Whee! Yeah, thank you.
Thanks. Bye.
And thank you for listening to the Loudest Podcast. We'll be back next week with your voicemails and a whole lot more. We love you. We'll talk to you later.
Bye!